page 501 in the church Bibles. So page 501. Esther chapter 1, and we're going to be reading verses 1 to 12. This is what happened during the time of Xerxes, the Xerxes who ruled over 127 provinces stretching from India to Kush. At that time, King Xerxes reigned from his royal throne in the citadel of Susa, and in the third year of his reign, he gave a banquet for all his nobles and officials. The military leaders of Persia and Media, the princes and the nobles of the provinces were present. For a full 180 days he displayed the vast wealth of his kingdom and the splendor and glory of his majesty. When these days were over, the king gave a banquet lasting 7 days in the enclosed garden of the king's palace, for all the people from the least to the greatest who were in the citadel of Susa. The garden had hangings of white and blue linen, fastened with cords of white linen and purple material to silver rings on marble pillars. There were couches of gold and silver on a mosaic pavement of porphyry, marble, mother of pearl, and other costly stones. Wine was served in goblets of gold, each one different from the other, and the royal wine was abundant in keeping with the king's liberality. By the king's command, each guest was allowed to drink without restriction, for the king instructed all the wine stewards to serve each man what he wished. Queen Vashti also gave a banquet for the women in the royal palace of King Xerxes. On the seventh day, when King Xerxes was in high spirits from wine, he commanded the 7 eunuchs who served him, Mehuman, Biztha, Harbona, Bigtha, Abagtha, Zethar, and Carcass, to bring before him Queen Vashti, wearing her royal crown, in order to display her beauty to the people and nobles, for she was lovely to look at. But when the attendants delivered the king's command, Queen Vashti refused to come. Then the king became furious and burned with anger. We're going to pray now. So let's bow our heads in prayer.
Okay, so Esther chapter, we're going to be reading verses 1 to 11. So back on to page 502 of the Church Bibles. Later, when King Xerxes' fury had subsided, he remembered Vashti and what she had done and what he had decreed about her. Then the king's personal attendants proposed, "Let a search be made for beautiful young virgins for the king. Let the king appoint commissioners in every province of his realm to bring all these beautiful young women into the harem at the citadel of Susa. Let them be placed under the care of Hegai, the king's eunuch, who is in charge of the women, and let beauty treatments be given to them. Then let the young women who please the king be queen instead of Vashti." This advice appealed to the king, and he followed it. Now there was in the citadel of Susa a Jew of the tribe of Benjamin, named Mordecai, son of Jair, the son of Shimei, the son of Kish, who had been carried into exile from Jerusalem by Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, among those taken captive from Jehoiakim, king of Judah. Mordecai had a cousin named Hadassah, whom he had brought up because she had neither father nor mother. This young woman, who was also known as Esther, had a lovely figure and was beautiful. Mordecai had taken her as his own daughter when her father and mother died. When the king's order and edict had been proclaimed, many young women were brought to the citadel of Susa and put under the care of Hegai. Esther also was taken to the king's palace and entrusted to Hegai, who had charge of the harem. She pleased him and won his favour. Immediately, he provided her with her beauty treatments and special food. He assigned to her 7 female attendants selected from the king's palace and moved her and her attendants into the best place in the harem. Esther had not revealed her nationality and family background because Mordecai had forbidden her to do so. Every day he walked to and fro near the courtyard of the harem to find out how Esther was and what was happening to her.
So yeah, over the next 4 weeks, we're going to look at a book which on the surface, as you kind of go through it, and do, if you get a chance, maybe just go home and read the whole lot. It won't take you 10 or 15 minutes. It could have the makings of a Disney classic. Once upon a time in a land far, far away, there was a beautiful girl called Esther. And what's not to love here? We'll meet a beautiful and courageous heroine, a thoroughly despicable villain. There's a kindly father figure. There's a powerful but slightly laughable king. The story has suspense, romance, drama, beautiful locations, and a kind of classic reversal of fortune. But even with all these elements, if we make this about heroes and heroines, behaviours of some which we should aspire to and behaviours of others that we should avoid, then we will do the book a terrible disservice. Firstly, because this gripping page-turner is not at all Disney fodder. It is incredibly dark. It's laced with murderous hatred and sexual exploitation of the worst kind. But it would also be a disservice because this book isn't actually about any of these characters per se, but about God. God at work in hidden ways, providentially using his people for his purposes. And that may seem strange, actually, because, as you may or may not know, God doesn't actually get a mention in this book. Not one. There's no explicit prayer or prophecy. There's nothing of God's law. God doesn't speak. In fact, Esther and Song of Songs are the only two Bible books where God isn't mentioned. Yet this, even in itself, helps us to understand something from it. Because even when things seem to the contrary, God is both watching and working for our good. And I try and illustrate this with a volunteer from the congregation who I confess to you is a plant. But Billy, can you come up and stand up here? And Billy, I'm going to tell you now, this bunch of keys is always going to be in front of your face. Okay?
Okay.
So, where are the keys?
In front of my face.
How do you know?
I can see them.
Okay. Can you put that on, please? Okay. Where are the keys?
In front of my face.
How do you know?
I can hear them.
Okay. And we'll try. Where are the keys?
In front of my face.
How do you know?
I can feel them.
Okay. Okay, where are the keys?
I don't know.
Where did I say the keys were?
In front of my face.
So where are the keys?
In front of my face.
Take off your mask. Give them a round of applause. Cheers, buddy. Thank you for doing that. Okay, well, friends, look. It's quite a nice little illustration that I came across. There are times in our lives when we do not see God, when we do not hear God,
when we do not feel God.
But he has promised never to leave us or forsake us. Our trust in his presence is not down to our feelings, but his faithfulness. And I think remembering that, maybe simple illustration will help us in our understanding of what down the years has actually been a pretty controversial book. On one hand, Jewish leaders have lifted the book quite high. It's explicitly Jewish. There are many references to Jews. Mordecai is repeatedly referred to as Mordecai the Jew, Haman as enemy of the Jews. But on the other hand, as late as the Reformation, Christians have struggled with its content. Actually, Martin Luther, the great reformer, said, "I am so great an enemy to the Book of Esther that I wish it had not come to us at all." Now, love as we do much of what Luther taught, we have to disagree here, don't we? Because through this book, we have something that is graciously given by God so we can see more of God, more of the beauty and truth of God, the beauty and truth of God revealed in the Lord Jesus. And I believe we'll see that. And so both Mike and I, over the coming weeks, want to carefully navigate us through some difficult issues so we see the real point. And when the book uses the designation Jew, which you see it does a lot, the writer Christopher Ashe helpfully comments that this is not at heart an ethnic marker, but a religious marker, specifically a covenant marker. It denotes the people who are in covenant with the God of the Bible. And we know, don't we, that there's a continuity between the Old Covenant Jews and the New Covenant people of God, made up of all who are in Christ, Jew and Gentile. All the promises of the covenant are yes in Christ. So this book has something to say to us even today as the covenant people of God. And it's a book that's set in Susa, the winter capital of the Persian Empire. The events span the 3rd, 7th and 12th years of Xerxes' reign, which was 486 to 465 BC. The book sits in the centre of the Jewish exile and return. So in the book of Ezra, we read that Cyrus had allowed some of the exiles to return to Jerusalem. That was 539 BC. Tens of thousands had done so, but not, it seems, the family of Esther and Mordecai. This is now 55 or 60 years after that, and large numbers of Jews still remain in the Persian Empire, many in the great imperial cities, including Susa. And in chapters 1 to 2, where we are today, we meet four of the main characters in the book. Count them as we go, starting with King Xerxes. Chapter 1 is really all about this king, and his excessive power and pomp is on display. So have a look down, chapter 1, verse 1. This is what happened during the time of Xerxes, the Xerxes who ruled over 127 provinces, stretching from India to Kush. At that time, King Xerxes reigned from his royal throne in the citadel of Susa. And in the third year of his reign, he gave a banquet for all his nobles and officials, the military leaders of Persia and Media, the princes, the nobles of the provinces were present. So we have an important king who, spoiler alert, will be revealed as a weak man. The powerful will be revealed, spoiler alert, as pretty puny. This is a man who basically works out a collection of impulses. He's consumed with being honoured and being and displaying his unarguable power and authority. And we're supposed to see this and be a bit impressed, actually, I think. He rules over our 127 provinces, from India to Kush, that's southern Pakistan to northern Sudan on a modern map. That time is basically the whole known world. So most humans at that time could have no chance of escaping from this. Now, forget high-speed aircraft travel. Most people's primary mode of transport was their feet. So with 127 provinces under his watch, there really was no hiding place. And so the writer invites us to see the power. Look at the text of those few verses. Verse 1, he rules. Verse 2, he reigns. He does so from his royal throne, the throne that's situated in the citadel. He meets nobles, princes and officials. It's not a subtle point about power that's being made, is it? During some later excavations of remains in Persepolis, which was the capital of Persia, which is Susa, where the summer holiday spot was, one engraving humbly stated this: I am Xerxes, the great king, the only king, the king of all countries, the king of this entire big, far-reaching earth. Can you imagine? At one time in history, there were kings and leaders and politicians with an inflated opinion of themselves. Unbelievable, isn't it? And we read on, verse 4, for a full 180 days he displayed the vast wealth of his kingdom, splendour and glory of his majesty. When these days were over, the king gave a banquet lasting 7 days in the enclosed garden of the king's palace. That's something, isn't it? Adequately displaying his splendour and grandeur took 180 days. Hey people, you want to see my splendour? That is going to take 6 months to show you. If you or I were going to organise an event to show our glory, you'd all be home for an early shower, wouldn't you? But then following that, another 7-day banquet for those in the city who had hosted this 6-month banquet. Lavish decor, verse 6, gardens with linen and marble pillars and couches of gold. Then verse 7, wine liberally served in golden goblets. And by the king's command, see it there, drinking without restriction. In other words, it was an open bar. Don't you love those weddings? Free bar! Yeah, I got a bit excited then. Anyway, But then we get introduced to Queen Vashti. And by the way, this isn't one of the four characters. She's got a minor role, although it's got huge consequences. The king, in verse 10, sees in high spirits, polite speak for totally off his face, probably, and he commands his advisers to bring Queen Vashti, who's hosting her own banquet. Why? So he can display her beauty, show off his trophy. And here we're supposed to see some humour, I think, because this powerful king, who controls 127 provinces, can't control his own wife. One writer suggested that if we're in the time of tweets, the hashtag would have been circulating, hashtag Vashti said no. He can command so much, but not the will of one person. We laugh, and the God of heaven laughs. You think you're a big deal, Xerxes? You're not. Psalm 2. The kings of the earth rise up and the rulers band together. The one enthroned in heaven laughs. The Lord scoffs at them. I have installed my king. Or as Ian Duggett comments, the empire is a glittering hologram. Back to this slightly awkward scene, verse 12. Sorry, Your Majesty, the queen refuses to come. And so verse 13, it's time to call in the advisors, seven of them. And imagine not so much the king and his magnificent seven, more like the king and his seven dwarfs, you know, dopey and sleepy. The king shows such weakness in the face of this refusal. He has no idea what to do. And the combined advice of this seven is to replace the queen. You know, if not, others will do the same. Verse 17, if the queen's conduct is known, all women will despise their husbands. But verse 20, aha, if we banish her from the king's presence, it will send a message for wives to respect their husbands. Friends, what a warped picture of marriage this is. How different from what we saw in Ephesians 5 just a few weeks ago. And the huge irony is, Vashti is forbidden from doing exactly what she'd first refused to do. Your punishment, Vashti, is you cannot come before the king. That's what I said. I don't want to. Vashti said no. So at the end of this chapter, this new law is sent out. It's the only way they can deal with it. Slap a new law in. And it raises the seed of a doubt. It raises a question in our minds. Perhaps all this power and pomp and impressiveness is not as invincible as it might appear. Which paves the way for our second character, Esther herself. And compared to that great power on display in chapter 1, this is more a picture of weakness and vulnerability. Now, if you think it was a case of Queen Vashti out, let's bring in a replacement post-haste, you'd be very wrong. Between the end of chapter 1 and the beginning of chapter 2, 4 years have passed. Remember, chapter 1, verse 3, it was the third year of the king's reign. Well, we see in verse 16 of chapter 2 that these events are now in the seventh year of his reign. What happened? It's not here, but it's well recorded elsewhere. Xerxes tries unsuccessfully to defeat the Greeks, but in the Battle of Salamis, the Spartans inflict huge casualties to the Persian army. So he returns to Susa, probably licking his wounds. But our writer just gives us none of that, skips it all, not interested. He focuses on two things, the fall of Vashti, the rise of Esther. And as we meet Esther, we find out two main things, her identity and her appearance. We're told she is the cousin and adopted daughter of Mordecai. We'll meet him shortly. We have no idea of how her parents died, but this orphan state underlines her weak position. And we'll see more of this identity in a moment. We'll keep it concealed for a while because that actually is precisely what she did. The other thing that we find out and sort of takes precedence in this chapter relates to her appearance. Verse 7, she had a lovely figure and was beautiful. What's that got to do with anything? Rather shallow detail. Well, it seems his attendants have a let's cheer up the defeated king plan, which involves gathering all the most beautiful virgins from the 127 provinces of his realm to see who most pleases the king and can be the new queen. Now, in parts of this story, we are supposed to see irony and humour, not here. Friends, dismiss the idea, if you have it, of a Miss Persia beauty pageant. This is forced entry. It's not a beauty contest, but a sex competition. It is a picture of sexual exploitation of epic proportions. It could not be more separated from the beautiful picture of a man and a woman coming together in the delight and tenderness of sexual union by the bonds of marriage. The boys didn't escape either. Hundreds of boys were taken and castrated for service in the Persian court. And Esther is brought to Susa under the care of Hegai, who was in charge of the harem. The harem host both concubines. Those were the ones who'd already slept with the king. And as such, they're not fit for marriage, which is repellent, isn't it? A world where people are useful only in terms of what they can do for me. Then as well as the concubines, you might get summoned from time to time, there were those who were being prepared for their one night with the king. And look at the process. It would be funny if it weren't so awful. Chapter 2, verse 12. Before a young woman's turn came to go into King Xerxes, she had to complete 12 months of beauty treatments prescribed for the women, 6 months with oil of myrrh and 6 with perfumes and cosmetics. And this is how she would go to the king. Anything she wanted was given to her to take with her from the harem to the king's palace. The result is Esther's chosen. Verse 17, the king was attracted to her. And don't get dewy-eyed and romantic. The word here is a base lust. And so verse 18, we have another banquet. The section begins with a banquet and one queen's dismissal and ends with another banquet and the crowning of Queen Esther. So that's all over this period of 4 years. I don't quite know what the correlation of it is. The beauty treatments took a long time. So we bring in our third character, Mordecai. This is going to help us understand a bit more about Esther's identity. Chapter 2, verse 5. Now there was in the citadel of Susa a Jew of the tribe of Benjamin named Mordecai, son of Jer, the son of Shimei, the son of Kish. So we have something here of the ancestry and identity, but also something about his present location. Firstly, we see he's from the tribe of Benjamin. And look at the genealogy. This goes back to Kish. Kish, who is the father of King Saul. And you may think, well, so what? Well, it's going to become hugely relevant as we go along. As a teaser trailer, the villain of the piece, who we'll meet later, is Haman the Agagite. He's descended from King Agag, who Saul was told to kill. Bitter enemies. So that's enough to make us say, oh, I think a showcase showdown is likely to be on the cards. But then as well as his Jewish identity, there is the fact that he is located in Susa, which basically means he's in exile. His ancestors were taken captive, not him personally, too long ago. But as you've seen, 55 or 60 years before, under Cyrus has been the opportunity to return. But for whatever reason, here he still is in exile, not in his homeland. So Mordecai is far from home. He's in exile in a pagan land, working in the citadel, living in this tension of being a citizen in this place, but faithful to his God. And this again is where the book is helpful, as we ask, how do we live faithfully in a place where we often feel like exiles? A place which we might describe as a post-Christian culture. Remember our recent series in Peter, written to exiles scattered. People may be feeling they don't belong. How can we live faithfully and fruitfully? It can be tempting to think, oh, you know, I long for past times when everything was so different back in the good old days. And truthfully, it wasn't probably in the way that our memory believes. Here's the encouragement. For most periods, and I think it's right to say most periods, God's people have lived in pagan cultures, yet often flourished. It may be hard sometimes, but there is the call to live faithfully. And he says, I will not leave you or forsake you. With Esther, we see her Hebrew name and her Persian name, Hadassah and Esther, a picture of this tension. Where will her loyalties lie? What will she most greatly value? And this, of course, is a challenge for us too, friends, isn't it, in our contexts? And as Mordecai sees his precious Esther taken for this gross spectacle, we also read this account at the end of chapter 2 of him uncovering a conspiracy. Glance down there. There's a plot to kill the king in verse 21. Somehow we see Mordecai finds out about it. He gets a message to Esther, who in turn reports it to the king. The plot's foiled, and importantly for later in the story, a record of Mordecai's action is made, no recognition given, but he ends the chapter sort of as a righteous man. Now, before we go to character four, at this point I was scribbling notes and struggling with some complexities. Because let's be honest, there's some sort of loose threads here, aren't they? Things we want to know that we're not told. When it comes to King Xerxes, his actions are off the scale awful, yet the writer never says as much as he or explicitly states how wrong it is. And in fact, the Bible writers often just describe a situation as it is. And Esther, what do we make of her? Is she willing or reluctant in all this? We make an assumption, I think, and it's probably a right one, but it doesn't actually say, is she happy to go along with this? Willing to compromise to advance her position, which would potentially have had great reward? Or is she forced to sleep with this dreadful pagan king and she's just simply doing what she has to survive? We're not actually told. What about Mordecai? How righteous is he? In verse 20, we see he's told Esther to keep her identity secret, hide her heritage. And when she was taken, did he try and step in to protect Esther from this abuse, or was there nothing he could do? Why did he uncover the plot against the king? A plot to get rid of this despot may have been no bad thing. Was he wanting to curry favour? We're not told. And actually, there's no point in our asking or moralising, because the writer doesn't invite us to do so. And remember how we started. This is not a book about heroes and heroines. If we just want to boo and cheer various characters, aspiring to some, decrying others, we miss the point. Whatever the case, the truth is, God's people are not perfect, but his plan is. God's people are not perfect, but his plan is. If these characters' imperfections, if our imperfections, disqualified us from being used by God for his purposes, then none of us would be used. Oh, that person there, you know, they had mixed motives. Yeah? Are your motives always pure? Friends, God is not scouring the earth to find a perfect servant. He sent one. God is not scouring Cranley to find a perfect servant. He sent one, Jesus. And any compromises that may or may not have been made in this story, and any compromises that we may or may not have made here in our lives, do not disqualify us from being used by God in the future. That's his grace. What a marvel it is. And it leads me to the fourth and final character that I want to introduce today. Who is it? No, I'm not going to introduce you to Haman today. It's God. You'll have to wait until next week for Mike to introduce you to the villain of the piece, Haman, and what a juicy part it is. The fourth and main character is God, unseen, not mentioned, but if we have eyes to see his handiwork throughout, he's everywhere, working in every situation. The places that people conveniently are, the things they can coincidentally overhear, the perfect timing of situations. Not just in chapters 1 to 2, but if we have eyes to see it throughout the book as it moves forward to, spoiler alert, deliverance. The deliverance not quite like the impressive Exodus with prophets and revelations and signs and wonders, but the writer here is cleverly showing us that even when it's not obvious, God is there. Gordon McConville writes, "The story is a powerful statement about the reality of God in a world from which he appears to be absent." You know, hello God, are you there? Can you hear me? Well, we see his providential hand. But we don't just see his providential hand here, but his favour I wonder if you saw this as we went through. Chapter 2, verse 9, Esther's entrusted in the harem to Haggai, and she pleased him and won his favour. Verse 15, it's not just Haggai, she won the favour of everyone who saw her. Building to verse 17, she meets the king and won his favour and approval. And he set a royal crown on her head. God's favour, here is his providential hand, his divine kindness, his work of grace, which we've seen before. You could do a little concordance check. Genesis 39, Joseph isn't in a pickle thanks to his brothers, but Joseph found favour in the eyes of Potiphar. He ended up in the position that God wanted him. Well, what a coincidence. In Exodus 3, the downtrodden Israelites are contemplating freedom. Moses questions God as to what power he might have with Pharaoh. God's response, I will make the Egyptians favourably disposed towards his people. And the psalmist says, Psalm 84, verse 11. For the Lord God is a sun and shield. The Lord bestows favour and honour. No good thing does he withhold from those whose way of life is blameless. What favour? It's providential care. His grace and favour. Does that not remind us of the grace that he shows to us? The unmerited favour of God in the Lord Jesus. Just reminded us of that series we were looking at recently in Ephesians 2 and verse 8 that says, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. What favour. And to apply this as we close this chapter, we might ask, how can we experience this? Frankly, we might say, you know, if God is so caring and kind and favour-showing and grace-filled, why is it not more explicit in this book? And I think it's because, and this is why I think this book's so wonderful, it's so often how we experience this in our lives. God is everywhere. He's always with us. He's right in front of us. But so often we don't see him or hear him or feel him. And it can be hard when he seems hidden. But that isn't to say he is not at work in his providence. He works out his purposes through the mess in our world and he saves his people. No power on earth can hinder the fulfillment of his purposes. And daily we need to detect his hand at work. Everything is from his hand, even when we fail to acknowledge it. I'm a bit frustrated now that the weather means that the grass is growing a bit more speedily. The mower's fired up a little bit more often. Well, that growth is from him. The food you're having for lunch. Oh, I know you went to Sainsbury's or had it delivered from a Ocado if you're posh. But it's from his hand. He's out of sight in Esther, and maybe we think in our lives, but he promises to protect and preserve his children. How? Well, by the one who will ultimately provide, the one who will bring about the salvation of the world. Would we look at Esther in this way in the coming weeks? Not about moral examples, you know, let's not behave like this, let's behave like that. But to see beyond that to the salvation of our God, illustrated by these characters, but pointing beyond them. A vulnerable girl is now queen. An overlooked man has saved the king. Maybe there is something in this seeming weakness. King Xerxes was all about his glory. Look where it got him. The King of Kings said this. Jesus called them together and said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. The greatest of his kingdom is not in self-promotion an outward show, but in the greatest act of self-denial. So we look to the cross. We consider all that he's done for us, and we're greatly humbled and overflowing with praise. May we consider that as we sing, as we take communion, and we continue the story in chapter 3 next week. Let's pray.